my attention turned to the corporate culture of Gazprom. This is something we haven't discussed today at all, really, or we've just touched upon it in a fleeting way. You have to remember, first of all, that Gazprom was basically formed by Viktor Chernomyrdin, the father of Gazprom, who coined the saying as Gazprom nas obshchiy dom, our common home is Gazprom. Applying to all of the Russian Federation. It was a corporate culture created by people who were gas professionals, who worked in the gas fields. I mean, Viktor Chernomyrdin was a roughnecker. He got out there and he was a foreman and he understood. And when you ever listen to Chernomyrdin talk, you'll understand what it's like, what he really is all about. Let me remind you that a number of years ago when there was the Chernomyrdin, who was the vice president?
Gore.
Gore, the Chernomyrdin-Gore Commission. The CIA sent a letter to Al Gore, saying that Chernomyrdin is a crook, that he's stolen so much and so much. And Al Gore wrote on the side of the memo, wrote down bullshit, and returned it to the CIA, saying, of course, that he trusts Chernomyrdin explicitly. And Bush eventually saw love and beauty in Putin's eyes. So, but let me give you another example of what Gazprom corporate culture was like. In 2007, in Moscow, there was a roundtable discussion between some Gazprom officials and journalists, Western journalists and Russian journalists. And one Russian journalist raised his hand and said, listen, the figures you just gave to this Gazprom official, he said, the figures you just mentioned, they don't jive with the figures I have. And he began, I don't recall all the details, it's not that important. The Gazprom official forgot to turn off his mic. His microphone, and turns to his colleague and says, "Кто он такой, бля? Убрать его нахуй. Who is this guy? Get him out of there," in a much rougher way. Now that's an indication of the corporate culture of the managers of this company. Let me give you another example of the corporate culture. In 2006, Gazprom decided to leak the identity of Dmytro Firtash and Ivan Fursin. How was it done? The editor of Izvestia, which a newspaper which at that time belonged already to Gazprom, got a call from a high Gazprom manager who said, look, we have an article for you. Print it. Articles printed under the name of a journalist that did not exist, that had never worked for Izvestia, nobody had ever heard of him, showing that finally Firtash and Fursin were exposed. At the same time, this high-level Gazprom manager told the Izvestia editor, look, I want you to put a twist on this article in a different one, attacking Yushchenko and the United States for messing around in things which did not concern them. There had to be an anti-US twist and an anti-Yushchenko twist, which eventually the Izvestia people did not put down themselves. Yeah. I mean, these might be minor points, but in the question of the intermediary companies, let me stick to Ross or Kernergo for a second. It is not really an intermediary company. I mean, if it limited itself to being an intermediary for 55 billion cubic meters of Central Asian gas, fine. Then it would play the role of a real intermediary, except that it didn't do anything. I mean, the gas is transported by Gazprom. They're the ones who control the Central Asia Center pipeline. Yeah, and the rest of it is filling out customs formation. Now, in 2006, in the January 2006 agreements, the cocktail imported a total of 67 billion cubic meters of gas. The mixture of Central Asian and Russian gas came out to 67 billion. This is according to the figures of the Energy Information Administration, which turned out to be 13 billion cubic meters more than Ukraine needed. Why? Why would the intermediary get 13 billion cubic meters more than its customer wanted? What was going on was they were getting 13 billion cubic meters at a very cheap discounted price and then selling it in Western Europe. Who were they selling it with? Their partner, Firtash, for example, who was buying gas on the cheap from Rosuker Energo. Firtash was buying gas from Firtash, selling it to the Hungarians through his company, Enfes Gas. At the same time, creating a number of various buying through political clout and protection in Ukraine. Buying what? In fact, enterprise called Krim Titan in the Crimea, Krim Soda, which is heavily gas intensive, buying Enfes Gas in Hungary, buying Rivno Azot in Ukraine in the city of Rivno. All these deals, when you go through them, involved either Raiffeisen Investments, either Mogilevich and his friends, in each one of these deals. And believe me, I do not believe that Gazprom did not know what was going on. And why was Gazprom, by creating Rosuker Energo, giving away its business to Rosuker Energo? Rosuker Energo became a competitor of Gazprom on the European market. They were directly competing with gas export. Now, why would they do that? Is there any logical conclusion, argument to this thing? Why would Alexander Medvedev, who when asked in 2006 by the Russian newspaper Vyedomosti, so who insisted on creating, on bringing Rosuker Energo into the picture? Who insisted on it? The Russians kept saying it was the Ukrainians. Ukrainians were saying, Prime Minister of Ukraine was saying, no, no, it was the Russians who insisted. They asked Alexander Medvedev, he says, I forgot. Whoa, you want to believe that? You believe in Santa Claus. Yeah. I don't want to continue. It's like, you're setting up a joint venture and you bring Al Capone in as your partner. Right? You got to understand that. It's not only a question of, we're going to be a moderating base, a base to discuss the prices. It's a discussion club, a debating society. It's not. It's a criminal enterprise. That's all it is. I cannot believe that Gazprom creates its own competition, allows gangsters into the business, allows other gangsters to buy up even more property, and then call it a basis for keeping the price of gas low. Total nonsense. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Roman, for these comments. And